Hello, it's Cheryl with eXp Realty, and I'd like to discuss the Indiana listing contract exclusive right to sell. With any contract, you have to have a few components for it to be legal and binding. You have to have the parties of which the contract is between. You have to have a beginning and ending date, and then you have to have what are the conditions for compensation. So that's basically what we have the listing contract for. It's to clear up any of those unknowns that a buyer, or excuse me, that a seller might have with their real estate agent, and to make sure that the real estate agent covers it clearly with their seller. So the next component we need to have is the price of the item we're going to sell and when the possession will take place. We prefer and recommend that it is in your best interest to give over the possession of the home at close of escrow. Pre and post possessions are pretty involved and typically not in the best interest of the parties. So, although it sounds like a great idea to a buyer and seller, it's really a risk factor for you. So, I would urge all of my sellers to please understand that your home will be turned over at close of escrow, so make sure everything is packed up and ready to go. And I'm sure that your listing agent, as I would, are going to talk to you about what are your contingency plans if your house you're moving to isn't ready to move into at the same time that you close on the home you're selling. That's always something that a seller has concerns about, and there are contingency plans that need to be discussed, and right now is the time to discuss those, not at the time of closing. There are a few things here that we need to discuss about the property. We need to know what the financial state of the property is. Is the loan current? Is it delinquent? Does the seller have any liens against it? Does the seller have the capacity to convey the property? Are they the person who actually has the deed? Are there other people on the deed? Another important thing is how did they acquire it? Did they acquire it in a tax sale, a sheriff's sale? How did they acquire the property? And is the seller a foreign person? Now, the seller may be subject to Foreign Investment in Real Property Tax Act if they are a foreign person, and that's very critical that we know. This section here refers to what type of financing will you accept from a buyer? Because there's different types of financing. Cash is always the best, that's going to be the easiest, and we would write that right here under Other. We would write cash. We're going to type it in right now. We would always take cash. The next best loan would be a conventional loan. An assumption of an existing mortgage is going to happen when the interest rates begin to rise and there are a predominant amount of low interest rate loans in the market. So that's when you're going to see people try to do assumptions rather than getting new loans because they can get them a little bit better interest rate. FHA, which is a government-backed loan, and VA, which is a government-backed loan as well. Now, your VA loans do come with certain restrictions as well as FHA based on the appraisals. So those would be your least desirable loans to accept on a offer. But generally, most people that get loans under $275,000 are going to be FHA loans. VA loans are good for the veteran. But if you get into a situation where you have multiple offers on your property and you had a cash offer, of course you would take it first. If you had three buyers, then one had a conventional mortgage, one had an FHA, and one had VA, and everything else about the buyers was identical, and everything else about the offers were identical, I would encourage you to go with the one that could get the conventional mortgage because those appraisals are a little bit different and a little bit less restrictive than your VA or FHA loans. The next area discusses what's going to stay and what's going to go. Anything that's built in typically stays. If it's not staying, we need to list it here. If you have a brand new stainless steel refrigerator that you bought last month and you're taking it with you, then we need to list that it's not conveying. We also need you to look at things around your house that appear to be permanent, but you're planning to take. If grandma's diamond chandelier is in the entry, and that's the first thing people see when they walk in, well, of course, they're going to want grandma's diamond chandelier. So it's in your best interest to take grandma's diamond chandelier down, have it cleaned, have it packed up, and put something else there in its place. It puts a lot of stress on a transaction when a buyer and seller are haggling over personal items that the seller doesn't want to convey. And we certainly, as real estate professionals, don't want our clients to feel under pressure because there's a lot going on when you're selling your home and there's a lot going on for that buyer. So we try to see what those bumps in the roads are and keep it just as good as it can get. So, from my real estate perspective and experience, take the things out of the house now that you're not planning to leave. Now, this is the portion of the employment agreement between the seller and the listing agent that discusses when we are owed commission. Basically, the parties understand and agree that this is an exclusive right to sell, which means that you can't have other realtors marketing the property for you. And that you sh and that the broker shall be entitled to the commission as established and payable upon the occurrence of any of the following events. The first event is we would be owed a commission at the time the property is sold to any person, including the seller, to any person during the term of this contract or any renewal or extension thereof. The second term would be we would be owed a commission at the time the seller or broker or any other licensee secures a buyer ready, willing, and able to purchase the property for such price and terms as specified, or such other price and terms as the seller may accept. So this is basically saying that if we bring a ready, willing, and able buyer that brings you a full price offer and meets all of your terms, and you reject it, we could still be, as brokers, eligible for commission. And trust me, if that's the situation, you're going to want to have a conversation with your broker. The third situation, at the time an agreement is entered into to sell during the term of this contract or any renewal or extension, and ultimately completed after the termination of contract, the broker would be due commission. Now, in simple terms, what that means is say you have a listing for 6 months, and on the day before the listing expires, you get just an absolute perfect offer, and you as a seller sign the offer and everything's ready to go. Well, obviously the listing's going to expire the next day, but the transaction is going to move forward. In those cases, the seller would still, if that co transaction gets to closing, be eligible for their commission. The fourth situation is if the property is sold or exchanged by a seller or any other persons within 120 days, a cooperating broker or seller provided. However, this extension clause shall not apply if this exclusive listing contract terminates and the property is listed exclusively with another licensed broker. So basically what that means is if your listing expires and the broker had a client that they had shown the property to that was ready to purchase it, and they came to you directly as the seller the day after it expired and say, "I want to make a deal with you directly." If it's within 120 days of that listing expiring, you would owe the broker commission. And it's really important that we discuss these items because you need to understand what your expectations are as a seller, because we're putting a lot of marketing effort and a lot of marketing dollars and a lot of marketing time into promoting your property and in making sure that the transaction goes smoothly, and we want to get paid for it. So we want things to be fair and equitable for everyone, and that's why they're listed here. Now, the fifth item is that the broker would be due commission if at the time of a default by the seller to any valid, fully executed written agreement to sell the property. Well, that basically means that if we bring a client to the table who has ready, willing, and able, they fully executed the contract, and maybe 2 weeks later the seller says, "Oh, I can't bear to leave because I can't take grandma's diamond chandelier down, and I'm not going to leave this house until I can." If we brought to the table a ready, willing, and able buyer, and we have a fully executed contract, the broker would be due the commission. And again, that's when you're going to want to have a conversation with your broker, because those things rarely happen, but it is important that we outline for you and explain to you what those terms mean. And I'm venturing to guess 90% or better of real estate agents do not cover these things with their clients because they feel that they're negative. In my opinion, they're not negative. As long as people know what the expectation is up front, then they know what they're obligated to do. Any commission required to be paid under the terms of 1, 3, and 4 above shall be due and payable at the closing of the transaction when title to or interest of the property is transferred. Any commission required to be paid under terms 2 and 5 shall be due and payable upon demand by the broker, and in the event the commission is not paid when due, the broker shall be entitled to that rate of 6% interest annum. So it's basically saying if you terminated the transaction or you decided you didn't want to sell for some other reason and you owed the broker commission, that you would owe it to them with interest due. And if the seller and buyer sign a purchase agreement or the closing of the sale, the property does not take place until after the term of this contract. The contract shall automatically be extended to coincide with the closing date or term of the lease. So the broker's commission is charged by the listing broker for services rendered with respect to the listing and is solely a matter of negotiation between the broker and the seller. It's not fixed, it's not controlled, or suggested, or recommended, or maintained by the Indiana Association of Realtors, any local board, listing service, etc. It's strictly between your broker and yourself how you want to handle the commission amount. This is exclusive to me, so I'm going to go through how I handle my listing commissions. First of all, I give people a choice of 6, 7, or 8%. An 8% commission would be on a luxury home, a higher-end home that might take a lot of marketing to sell. The higher the price the home is, the longer they sit on the market, and the more challenging it is to get a buyer to the table. So, of course, that increases the marketing costs. So, we might have to do special events or things like that, and in that situation, we would charge a higher listing percentage because we are going to be spending more money to get that listing. Basically, most realtors do three things. They put a sign in the yard, they place it in the MLS, and then they pray that the home is going to sell. And that would be a 6% listing. Well, we typically do more than that. We put a sign in the yard. We put it in the multiple listing. We're going to put it out amongst a lot of internet sites. We're going to push to get you to the front page of Google for your specific listing. We're going to be doing a lot of things. We're going to be doing mailers. We're going to be talking to your neighbors. We're going to have open houses. We might even have a special open house for your neighborhood before the listing goes live. Because really, what a better chance to pick your neighbors than at an open house, right? So that would be a typical 7% listing. So I let my clients choose what they're going to pay me. Will it be 6%, 7%, or 8%? The other thing that I want you to understand about this section is that in the event of a purchase option, the seller agrees to compensate the broker the consideration paid for an option. Now, we don't deal with a lot of options these days, and in most situations, we're not going to have that situation, but my commission in that instance would be the same. And in the event that you lease the property, we're not working with leases. We would have a different purchase agreement and everything on a lease. So I don't do leases. I usually refer those to a lease specialist. So my little thing is a little hash bar there. And I do this for anyone that. Should the seller procure a ready, willing, and able buyer, and the buyer and seller are both represented by the listing agent per the limited agent agreement, the commission would be reduced by X percent. And typically that's 1%. Now, when we get here to line 79, 80, and 81, what this describes is how commissions are paid. So up here you've picked what you're going to pay me, and this tells you what I'm going to share with a cooperative broker. So I'm going to put everything in the MLS, I'm going to market it out there, and most of the time it's another broker who brings the buyer for your properties. Very rare is it that you bring your own buyer to your own properties, and we discuss that when we discuss limited agencies. So I have to share my commission with that broker that brought the buyer to the table to put the offer in on your home. And in my case, I pay 3% to that buyer's agent because we want to encourage them to bring all the buyers they can to look at your home, and hopefully one of them brings the one that finds it the ideal perfect home for them. I don't like to go any less than 3% because it's not much of an incentive for a real estate professional. Although it's not part of our ethics to not show houses that are less than a certain price, we all know that there are probably people out there that won't show properties if they don't feel like they're going to earn enough money. And I can't control that part of it, but what I can control is what I share with them when they do bring the buyer. This section here talks about commissions and attorney's fees, and basically, if there's a conflict, whoever the successful party is will pay the attorney's fees and court costs along with the damages and whatnot. This section here talks about that the broker is authorized to accept the earnest money and hold it in escrow or trust. And in the event the seller receives any portion of the earnest money, the seller authorizes the broker to keep any earnest money deposits up to the amount of the commission that would have been if the sale was completed in payment for the broker's expenses, services, and advertising. And this is something that you want to talk with your individual broker about how they're going to handle that. But the contract does state that if that they could hold the earnest money up to the amount of the payment of the contract. Now, in most cases, if a deal falls through, and they do on occasion, sometimes these things just weren't meant to be, but it usually means there's something better coming right behind it. And so if that deal falls through and you are awarded the earnest money based on the purchase agreement terms, then you would probably, in my situation, I would split that earnest money, and I re reference that a little bit later on, so that the seller would get half and I would get half, and we're going to put that house right back out on the market and find us another buyer. This section here talks about the multiple listing service and internet and media advertising, and that we're going to show you a list of items that we're going to publicize, and we're going to have you review those. Any information that you provide to us, we have to act as if it is true, and that we have complete and full authority to act on the behalf of the owner as far as publishing that event and marketing it. Environmental contaminants advisories or release. If your home was built prior to 1978, there would be a lead paint disclosure. And any other type of environmental contaminants, radon, mold, biological contaminants, anything like that must be disclosed. And then this section here talks about that you agree to consult with appropriate experts, and that you accept all risk for environmental contaminants, and that you hold harmless the brokers and their companies and licensees from any and all liability, including attorney's fees, costs arising out of or related to any inspection result, repair, or deficiency affecting the property, including the environmental contaminants. That's a mouthful. These are rare instances, but they do occur, and that's the reason there's a note in there about that. We have reviewed the office disclosure, so that is in a separate vi video, so I'm going to go on and peruse through that because it's identical to that other policy that we have already discussed. And then this just talks about authorization. The seller agrees to the broker to give us the required information so that we can enter into the listing service and to all of our other marketing, that you authorize us to cooperate with other brokers, that the seller provides us with keys to access the property, that the seller authorizes us to have duplicate keys made if need be, that the seller agrees not to rent or lease the property during the term of the listing contract without written notification. Seller agrees that the broker may work with other buyers and other sellers to assist in performing broker's duties. Seller grants to broker an exclusive non-revocable copyright license to disseminate, publish, modify, and reproduce all of the content of this listing contract, but not including but not limited to price and terms, financing, closing sales, photographs, drawings, written descriptives, narratives, motion pictures. Basically, you're giving us authorization to market your product with everything within the terms of this agreement. and that the brokers, upon request and to the listing service, internet, or any other advertising media, the seller agrees that the broker shall own all rights, title, and interest to these items, including but not limited to any copyright and property images taken by the broker's photographs or agents, which basically is saying we're going to be taking the photographs or have a professional photographer, therefore we own the photos. The seller authorizes its utility companies to divulge information to the broker. I request of all of my sellers that they provide us with that information so that we have it before listing, because every buyer wants to know about the utilities. So put that on your little homework list that you're going to need to get your utilities and at least do back 12 months worth of utility bills. If you don't have them, you can call the utility company and they can provide you with that information. Again, every buyer wants to know, and when you move to your next location, you're going to want to know that as well. The next section 8 talks about HOAs. We need you to give us the information about the HOA company, their contact information, what the fees are, how often you pay them, and when they are paid through. And if you have receipts for those payments, we'd like to have those. And in many cases, if it's a large homeowners association fee, we may ask you to get the homeowners association to provide us a statement that you have made your payments through such and such a time. The next one is that the seller authorizes the lending institution to give us information about the mortgage, information to the broker, and to provide copies of the note and the mortgage if requested. That's more typical of the buyer's agent needing that than the seller's. What we need to know is, do you have clear and marketable title? So we might have to ask Magnificent Mortgage to let us know if you're current on your mortgage payments and if you have the ability to give clear and marketable title. Number 10 is that the seller is authorizing the broker to disclose the written offers to the buyers, which means if you have multiple offers that we can say, yes, we have multiple offers. This is a negotiable item that we can write in other areas. So perhaps maybe you want us to tell buyers that, yes, we have other offers, but I'm not allowed to disclose the amounts of those offers. But we can disclose the existence of them, and there are forms to handle that as well. Lockbox, this section here authorizes us to use a lockbox and put the keys in them, and that it holds us harmless from any claims from third parties from loss or damage. So please take all your valuables out of your home. Remember, we're going to be taking photographs of your home. Take anything personal down. Take anything that might draw attention, because they are going to be marketed out there. And honestly, we can't control who's looking at them. But you want to market your home. You want to get it sold. So just take the average precautions that most people would take and take those things out of the home, pack them up, get them someplace secure, so that when people are walking through your home and seeing things, they're not seeing anything of sentimental or high dollar value. This is the Fair Housing Statement. And you've heard the Fair Housing Statement before, but we're going to hear it again. The parties acknowledge that the Fair Housing Act prohibits discrimination in housing because of race, color, national origin, religion, sex, familial status, and handicap. The National Association of Realtors Code of Ethics also prohibits realtors from discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation or gender identity. So, that means that we can't publish your house and say, we don't want people with kids buying our house. We don't want a Catholic to buy our house. We don't want somebody with a specific handicap to buy our house. We can't say that. We won't say that. So hopefully you understand the reasoning behind that. It's very important, because everybody that has the ability to pay should have the right to live where they want. So this is what Fair Housing stands for. I am a proponent of it, and I believe that we sell to everyone. So as long as you agree with that, then everything should be great. Then these are the additional provisions. I'm going to ask that you read through these on your own. I have a copy for them. They're pretty standard. There are not a lot of companies, or excuse me, there are not a lot of questions usually ask about this state portion. It's pretty straightforward. But if you do have questions about it, please make sure that you understand that you can call or email me at any time at 602-206-4773, cherylmoore.realtor@gmail.com. The next section talks about wire fraud. And wire fraud is on the rise. So, any information you receive about or electronic communication that you receive about direction of your funds, transfers, or whatever, please, even if it appears to be from me or the title company, your mother, your brother, your sister, please verify the authenticity by the direct communication to the person that sent it. So if it came from me, you call me and you say, "Did you send me this document?" And I'm going to have you read it to me. You're going to call the title company. "Did you send this wire document on transferring funds?" And you're going to have them verify that with you with the information that's on there. Because wire fraud again is on the rise. There's a couple of additional things that I put here in the listing contract, and we're going to go on down to little letter number N, further conditions. These are the things that I put into further conditions, and I think it's important that we put it down. And we talked about it a little bit above. This contract states that the broker can actually keep the earnest money if it's awarded, if a contract fails to close, that the broker actually can keep all of the monies up to the point of it covering the listing commission. And I put this in here because I want to let my sellers know that we're in this together. So, should a purchase agreement be negotiated and accepted during this contract and the purchase agreement terminate with the seller awarded the earnest money, 50% of the earnest money shall be awarded to the listing agents for cost incurred. I also list that the seller is to authorize in writing a date to activate the listing. And the reason I do that is because you may want to not put it on the multiple listing for a few weeks, but we want to go ahead and get started and get working on it. So we're going to sign the contract and have it start today. But it may take us a week or two for it to get it prepped and get the pictures in and get the post in the yard. So we're asking that you authorize this in writing to activate the listing so that because we are required by the MLS to put listings on within 48 hours of signing these agreements. Well, I don't know about you, but I don't know too many sellers that can actually get their home ready in 48 hours. So that statement there gives us a little extra time to go ahead and get ready, get prepared, get ready to go, and then we'll have you sign the document prior to listing it live. It's still a valid contract. You're still under obligation to pay if we find a ready, willing, or able buyer. Yet it does give a little bit of extra time to prepare the marketing and for you to prepare your home for listing. And one of the last statements that I put in here is another statement for my sellers to make them understand that we are a team. Our intentions, we have promise, a promise to deliver more than you expect and to make this experience more than you could ever expect from any other real estate professional. But sometimes things don't go as planned and people can't come to terms. So should the broker be unable to remedy the problems, that the seller may opt to cancel this agreement in writing and pay $500 towards the agent's incurred marketing fees. So, I intend to sell your home and do my very best to earn that commission. And I just want you to know that if the situation gets to a point where we can't resolve our issues, that we are going to be able to talk about it and get them resolved. Or we could just agree that maybe the best thing would be for you to move on to another realtor. And I'm pretty sure you've never heard anybody say that before. But there are a lot of things to take into account because, first of all, as a real estate professional, I am going to put all of my effort towards selling your home. And I want to make sure that you understand that. And I want to do everything possible to come to terms with anything that you direct me to do. And yet, at the same point, sometimes people don't have a meeting of the minds. And when that happens, then everybody needs to understand, you know, what is the alternative? And if we talk about that now, we already know that. So that's really the listing agreement. If you have any questions, please call me again at 602-206-4773, or you can email me at cherylmoore.realtor@gmail.com. And of course, you always have the right to seek the advice of independent counsel, your accountants, attorneys, or anyone prior to signing any agreement. Hope that was informative. Thanks, and have a great day.